Good evening.
Praise the Lord.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Good to have you folks out tonight. You could be out on the lake boating or something, but you're here instead. Isn't it great to be in the house of the Lord?
Amen.
And it's great to be together with God's people. I don't even know a lot of you folks tonight, but you're part of my family.
Amen.
So hopefully I'll get to know you maybe even after church is open. Maybe you're a church. Who knows? Who knows what God's going to do in our midst tonight? We just saw His will. We're turning it over to Him. And we're going to believe and trust together. Amen?
Amen.
Would you bow your heads with me for a word of prayer, please? Father, we thank You tonight, Lord Jesus, for the privilege that we have, Lord, of being called the children of God. And then, Lord, of being called the body of Christ. And that body has many members in it, Lord. And Father, we are each one a member of that body. We have a role to fulfill, something that You've called us to do, something that You've laid on our hearts. And even for this service tonight, God, You want to raise up the body of Christ to come together and exalt Your name and lift You on high. Lord, You're worthy tonight, Father. You are an awesome God. We worship Your majesty, Your power, Your glory, Lord Jesus, tonight, Your holiness, Father, tonight. You are perfect in all of Your ways, God. And we see You tonight, Lord Jesus. Though we are small in number tonight, God, we are big in hearts. We are big in hearts that want to worship You and lift up Your name and glorify You, God. And we pray, God, that You'll come and touch our hearts and stir our souls tonight within us, Lord. And if there's anything that's slumbering in us tonight, Lord, wake it up, we pray. Father, help us to be on fire for You and ready to go and glorify You tonight. And all we do is say, bless Brother Brad when he preaches later in this service. Bless this worship team as they lead us now. Bless our hearts as we worship, God. Help us to open up and truly, freely worship You. In Jesus' name we pray, and all the people say,
See you. Pastor Nicky said, I'm going to buy something this time. He got a banana or something. And I said, okay, Flynn and myself in this time, so I was going to the coffee, and we met a gentleman that just started talking to me. We ended up being able to pray with him, pray with his son, and we just had many encounters of people. People are hungry, they're out there, they want to hear the word of God, and another young person in that convenience store in Jefferson, God brought people to us that we knew, new people, and just recently we were able to minister to a woman specifically. Her name is Mallory, and I don't think she'd be upset if I didn't get my Easter name. She was at the Garden Square Apartments, and we went a couple months ago there just to minister there, just to witness. And she and her significant other there, we were talking with her, found out that she had been premature. She only weighed just over 1 pound, like under 2 pounds. She had a picture of that. And that day, when we told her about Jesus, that he loved her, she really knew that that was why she had, that she was on the earth, and that Jesus did love her. So she was hit by the tornado, and so we've been able to continue to have contact. I see her at Rural King sometimes, and we're able to have some contact and try to love her. So I'm just really thankful that I'm changed. You know, I'm changed because we're able to do this, and this is our heart, and we have the opportunity to go out and be involved, whether it's a pastor's. I go to a pastor's prayer meeting that's like a comfort to me. It's like security. Because I'm on the council, and there's a lot of things on the council that I don't really appreciate. But, you know, I'm thankful that I'm there. I'm thankful for the people that I'm working with and their souls that they need Jesus. And I mean, I'm not saying where they're at, but I'm just saying that there's things that are disheartening on the council. So this is comfort for me, my prayer meeting on Wednesday night at my church, but also this small group that we have on Tuesday night has just been helpful. My sister is a little bit of my sister to some extent too. So we're crying out for Kokomo. We're in prayer for people, just everything, young, old, the needs. We're trying to keep things current. And the Light and Darkness Ministry, we have a representative there also, Paul Schrock, because it's an update on the Light and Darkness. If anybody doesn't know, that's where the women go in the bars. They actually go in the bars and talk to these ladies. They bring gifts to them. Deborah, you can talk about that. So I'm going to hash one out.
You're doing a good job, Cindy. Because I wanted to acknowledge Pastor Wayne's prayer meeting. See, what we're hearing here is that the chance to step out and find how great a God is. And all over our city, prayer is increasing. We have a prayer meeting every Tuesday night for the community at Brookside. And as Cindy referenced, people coming together to pray. We have a monthly prayer meeting around about the last Monday of every month going on. We have women going into the and all these opportunities are open for everyone to get involved in. And I was actually going to ask you, Pastor Deborah, just one brief story from the last month or two. You're going into, this is bold, there's a team of ladies, they're going into...
Church ladies.
They're called church ladies. The bouncers call them church ladies, and they're scared of them. And going into adult nightclubs with the love of Jesus.
We actually have had quite a few ladies recently that have left. And some of them are actually, they've entered into, I don't call it the church life, but you know what I mean? They're actually on their own, going and bringing their families and some of their husbands and things are still. We're starting to see some cool stuff like that happen. We've seen a lot of, something used to be going very loving, but sometimes the Lord just, you know, like give a rebuke. And there was a man who was a doorman at one of the places, and he kept insisting. And he was a believer, and so each time I would challenge him, and then finally I just, you know, I said, "Brother, why are you here?" And he said, "Well, you know, I bought this boat," and I said, "You stop right there, my brother." I said, "Will you really stand before Jesus Christ and tell him that you were pimping women to pay for a boat?" And he told the owner that he would not come back, and he said, you won't see me here anymore. But then now there's another man that's come in, and so Monday night, I just kind of felt like I'd go over and speak to him, and he said, "I was wondering when you guys were going to come and talk to me, you've been ignoring me." I said, "No, sir, I promise you we haven't." And he said, "Well, I've sat here, and nobody's ever come over and talked to me," and I said, "Well, tonight's your night." And he said, "So what's the word?" And I said, "Do you really want me to tell you what the word is?" And he said, "Well, yes, ma'am." And I said, "It's hope." And he just let me share with him and pray with him. And he said, and he pointed to a guy, and this guy is the bouncer. He pointed to a guy at the end of the bar, and he goes, go give him hope. And so he'd say, go give that one hope. So here's the bouncer telling me that needs prayer. And so at the end, as we've been ready to leave, there was a group of ladies and patrons all kind of sitting together. And one of the ladies grabbed me and hugged me, and she said, will you pray for us all? And so I was able to, you know, to pray over them. And they you know, we kind of have an idea about who folks are, and but you know what? That, you know, when somebody just loves them right where they're at, and not afraid to give them a hug right where they're at, or to, you know, and if the Lord, you know, gives us a review too, that when, you know, when it's in season and it's right, then there's fruit. And so, yeah, we're just very thankful for everything that God's doing.
Amen.
Thank
you.
And I had to feel like I opened the door to preaching there too.
Well, that's so good. Preaching, we'll come to you. Just get up out of your seats, mingle, and just go join one of these leaders and just make it, just join hands, make a little prayer circle, and let's pray into that for 5 minutes right now.
Come here.
Yes.
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 came together. And I'm looking forward to hearing Pastor Brad come and share a word with us tonight. Pastor Jesse, would you say a little prayer with Pastor Brad before he comes to Lord help him as he comes to share? Father God, our city is desperate for words of hope. This is no time, this is no season to play games or to have pretense about who we are or what your body is capable of, Lord God. You have called us into the world to transform it, to bring reconciliation, Lord God, to bring truth. Tonight I pray over Pastor Brad, not just your anointing, but your unction. Lord, may he draw out the truth of your word. May we feel it in our bones, Lord God. May our spirits be revived. May your Holy Spirit fall. Father, thank you that he is faithful to you. Thank you, Lord God, that he is an ambassador of your word. And Lord, give him power to speak in Jesus' name.
I'm not going to attempt to sing that song.
So Lord, seated on the throne,
it was taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 6. Isaiah, it said in the year the king Uzziah died, he said, I saw the Lord, and he was high. Lifted up, and his train filled the temple. I want you to try, I know it's impossible for us to see what Isaiah saw, but it's important to know when he saw the Lord. It was in the year that his king had died. He was a good king for most of his reign. Zechariah was the prophet of Uzziah. When Zechariah died, the prophet of the Lord, it shook Uzziah. Uzziah began to err in his ways, but he was still the king. Here is a young Isaiah. And he said in the year that he died, it was a troubling time. It was a very difficult time for this nation because their king had died unexpectedly. But it was in that time when Isaiah could say, I saw the Lord, and he was high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. I want you to look with me in the book of Job, chapter 42. I will not be long. I think I have about 15 or 20 minutes. But what's ironic, I should not use that word ironic, what's amazing to me, Monday I was scheduled to travel. I was going to be gone all day, and I woke up that morning and I thought, I don't feel like traveling today. How many of you know, have felt that magnet of God draw you into particular places? You felt him drawing you to prayer. You felt him that draw into his word. I woke up and I felt like I needed to get into my study. And I need to get away from everybody else and walk into my closet and shut the door, and I did. I just opened the book and God began to speak to me. I want you to understand the time frame of this. I'm born and raised in this city. I've pastored in Jackson, Mississippi. I've pastored in Muncie, Indiana. My heart had always been to come back home. There's something about home. I've never had a forum to speak to. I've spoken a few churches here in town, not many, because I've been away. And I sit there, Pastor Nikki, in my office, and the Lord began to speak to me about Kokomo. I was like, I couldn't completely wrap my mind around Kokomo because I didn't know I was going to have any forum at all to speak to a group of people from a variety of churches about our city. So I sit there, and God began to show me some things in particular. Now, I audibly asked God, I said, I love what I'm seeing here, and I agree with it, God, but at what point am I going to be able to speak this? On Wednesday, I come to the prayer meeting here in the other room, and in fact, I hadn't planned on being here because circumstances had just dictated that I had stuff going on because of the tornado. And I walk in this room at 12:30, and I hear Pastor Nicky say they had some loose ends they had to kind of tie together. And he, I ask him later, I said, what kind of loose ends are you talking about? I said, well, we need a preacher, we need a worship leader. I said, I need you a worship leader. And he said, well, I was going to ask you to preach. And I was like, okay. I see where God's going with this. Let me ask you a question. How many of you have been out in the public somewhere and you look at somebody, you see somebody that you know, but you can't figure out how you know them? You see a face, you see a person, and you're scratching your head, and you're thinking, I know you, but I can't place you, I can't figure out how I know you. That never happened to anybody but me. Yeah. There's a guy the other day that had left his work, and he went to the store to get some supplies, and while he was in the store, a woman walked up to him and said, I know this is going to sound crazy, but I know you from somewhere, and I've been looking at you, and I can't place where it is I know you. He looked at her with a funny look. He said, honey, I'm your husband. My point is, when we see people out of character or out of the place that we're used to seeing them, we struggle with their identity sometimes. And this is something that I want to show you tonight. This is what y'all have shown me. I remember a few years ago, we prayed the prayer of Jabez. Remember the Jabez prayer, that books were written about Jabez, and everybody in America jumped on the Jabez bandwagon. And the Jabez prayer was simply, oh God, expand my borders and bless thee. So because we discovered that prayer somewhere, everybody jumped on board. Oh God, expand my borders and bless me. We are a generation that understands all the blessings of God. We hold true to the promises of God that are going to bless us. I came from a group of people years and years ago that stood on foundations like what Paul told the Galatian church, that God shall supply all my needs according to his riches which are in glory. David said, I was young, and now I'm old. You can help me with this. And I've never seen the righteous forsaken or their seed begging bread. And we attach ourselves to the blessing scriptures or the promise scriptures that somehow are going to benefit us. But when something happens to our lives, we have become so attached to the blessings of God or the promises of God, when something thwarts our walk with him, it's almost that we don't recognize this God because he's out of character with us. Paul makes a very pointed remark to Timothy. He said, if you're going to walk godly in Christ Jesus, somebody help me here. He said, if you people are going to walk godly in Christ Jesus, I got a promise from the Word of God for you. You shall suffer persecution. Somebody say amen. Amen. We don't like those scriptures. In fact, we just assume doing, I don't want to know anything about persecution. But I want you to understand something. If we're not careful, we will not recognize God in the midst of adversity, and it is where God exactly wants us to see him in his fullness.
Amen.
I get excited when I preach, so bear with me for just a minute, okay? I've got 4 minutes and 52 seconds and I'll be done. Job chapter 42. Have you got that? I got it. Listen to this. He said, I know you can do all things, and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Who is this that hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore I have uttered what I do not understand. What's he talking about? All his questions as to why has all this happened to me. Let me back up to the first chapter of Job. Because all Job knew about God was the giving side of God. There was not a man on the planet that was more blessed than this man. He had more cattle, he had kids, he had homes, he had everything. And all Job had ever known was that side of God. You know the story how Satan came before God and said, "Let me have it." But what God intended for Job to experience was the other side of who he was. Now watch this. He said, "I have uttered things that I do not understand, things too wonderful for me, which I did not know. Hear, and I will speak. I will question you and make it known unto me." Here's where I wanted you to pay attention. He said, "I have heard of you by the hearing of the ear. But now my eyes see you." Where to see? Prior to he had heard of him in the hearing of the ear on the blessing side, the giving side of God. Job goes through something I would wish on no man on this earth. Job goes through a travesty of loss, a time of questioning. But it was there that he could see the hand of God in his life. I can testify in 34 years walking with God. I love the blessings of God. I love the giving part of God. But I have learned what draws me nearer to him are the afflictions and the adversity that come into my life, because it is there that I can say, just like Job, now I see who God really is. Somebody say amen. Amen. So what's that got to do with Kokomo? I get stuck in Acts a little bit. On Monday, I was reading about Paul and the trip that he took from Crete, and he warned them, he said, "You should not make this trip." And then God redirected something to me back to the book of Acts chapter 1. Now watch this, because what Jesus promised his disciples was three things, basically. He said, "You're going to be fearless, you're going to have a whole lot of joy, but you're going to be in a whole lot of trouble." That's basically what he promised the book of Acts, the disciples. You're going to be fearless. Were they a fearless group of men? They were fearless. You're going to have all kinds of joy, but you're going to be in constant trouble. There had to be a supplement in their lives so they could have this fearlessness, this joy, and understand that they were going to face difficulties. So he said this to them. He said, "Don't worry about it. When things seem over your head, I want you to remember something. They're underneath God's feet all the time." So he said, "I'm going to give you power." Watch what he said. "I'm going to give you power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you." He said, "You're going to be witnesses to me both in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the uttermost part of the earth." That's what he said. Now look at how the Spirit of God fell on the early church. They're doing amazing things in the city of Jerusalem. In fact, for 7 chapters, the church had become very popular. There was some minor glitches here and there were persecuted, but not so much. In fact, I would maybe say that the early church had become comfortable in Jerusalem, because they were not fulfilling what Jesus said they would do. He said, "Not only in Jerusalem, but in Judea, in Samaria, and to the uttermost part of the earth." That's what he told them. For the first 7 chapters, things are going well in Jerusalem. And then all of a sudden, Stephen is put to death. And as we begin the 8th chapter, there at the feet of what happened with Stephen stood a man named Saul. You can disagree with me if you want to, but this is what I believe. I believe that God had raised up a Saul. Because you want to know what happened in the 8th chapter of the book of Acts? The Bible says a great persecution had come, and the church began to scatter where? To Judea, to Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. But they did it preaching the word, and they did it with great joy.
Amen. Hallelujah.
You read throughout the books of that, book of Acts, every time the church got persecuted, they became stronger and stronger and stronger. What is the purpose of the persecution? Look, history repeats itself, and this is what I believe. I believe we're not too far away from what happened a long time ago in this nation alone. I do not believe that the church is too far away from a persecution that we have never seen the like of. But don't worry, because God has given us power, He's given us joy, He's given us a fearlessness that we will be able to stand against the test of time. So He raises up a Saul, and the Bible says that Saul is breathing out these threatenings and these slaughters against the church. He had a mandate for this guy, and he didn't even know it. Paul had a date with God. Paul was the big modern of his day. Paul's on his way to Damascus with letters to kill these Jews. We're going to get rid of them. That's what they thought when they crucified Jesus. They thought they got rid of the problem. What they didn't really realize was that 3 days later, he was going to get up off the ground, and the problem had just started for them. Oh, God. Shines out of heaven. He knocks him off his horse, and what do you know? He can't see. He said, "Why do you persecute me, Saul?" Wait a minute. Lord. He sends him into Damascus. Here's a funny story. God appears to a man named Ananias, just setting their mind on his own business. And God says, look, I want you to go to Damascus, to a street called Straight, because there's a man named Saul there, and I want you to witness to him. He's like, well, hold on, dude. Do you realize what you're asking me to do? I'm going to knock on this door, and he's going to chop my head off. Watch what he said. And this is what I believe that God has spoken to us. He said, I have chosen, he said, this man is a chosen vessel for me to bear my name to the Gentiles. I'm going to show him what he must suffer for my name. Paul was a forerunner to the church. Paul was the one that was going to carry 2/3 of the Word of God into the hearts and the lives of people. But God needed a man that was going to be willing to walk through persecution, to walk through difficult times, to understand taking 39 stripes, save one on his back, to be shipwrecked, to be betrayed by his countrymen and his friends, to lay the weight of robbers. He needed a man that was going to say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. He was going to set up precedence. And this is why I felt God speaking in my life on Monday morning as I sit there. That somebody always has to be a set of precedence so somebody else can follow. A week ago, my son-in-law walked into my living room. He does restoration like your husband does. And they deployed him to Kokomo. And he's over in Cedar Crest. And he's doing all kinds of work. And my son-in-law, this little girl's father, said to me no less than 5 times. No less than 5 times. He said, I am blown away at the city of Kokomo and how they are rallying themselves together around each other. He said there were people coming out of the woodworks asking me if I needed this or I needed that. We've headlined Channel 6, Channel 8, Channel 13, Fox, National News. Oh, I hope you're getting this. I'm not mad. 38 seconds. Nathan had no idea, come Monday and Tuesday, that a storm was going to hit this city as he put a tent up in a parking lot on an empty field along the way. See, I dance at my church, and I got a dance on me right now. We have no idea what God has in store for us. We have no idea what God has in store for a football team in a high school in this city. How many are willing to take the platform for God and say, you know what? Come what may. Come on. How many are willing to take the platform and say, I don't care what hell throws in front of me. I've got joy, I've got power, and I've got the love of God. Somebody give me a hand of praise in this house. So, he goes to the city. He raises up this man. Paul spends 3 years in the house of command. You know, a lot of times, and I promise you I'm not done, but a lot of times, had we known the things that we had to walk through to get where God wants to take us, we would say no. Remember the song Garth Brooks sang, The Dance? Had President Kennedy known that he was going to be assassinated, would he have ever run for president? Had we known the circumstances that lay in wait for us, would we continue to go forward? A lot of us would say no. There's a lot of circumstances that I have walked in and seen to get where I am today, my relationship with Him, that I don't know that I would say yes. I don't know. But I believe Paul knew, because the words of Jesus says, I've got to show this man the things that he's going to suffer so that he can bring the gospel to the Gentiles. I believe 3 years that he spent in exile was getting an understanding, preparing himself. Because you're going to reveal the glory of God to a church that needs to be adopted by Him. And this is where I want to close. This morning I spent just a few minutes. I didn't get an opportunity to preach my church this morning. I already had somebody, that was a hard thing. I didn't get to be honest, I was jumping up a bit. Especially when I read this passage of scripture. How many of you people have in this room praying for certain things right now that you've been praying so long and still waiting for those things to come to pass? A lot of you. Long, long time. Bible says that the lot fell on Zacharias to enter into the temple as he's trying to offer incense to God. Commentaries differentiate on whether this was his first time or his 10th time. Personally, I believe because of the thousands of priests that were in Jerusalem, I think this was his first time. And he walks in and he throws incense on the hot coals, and the smoke arises before God. And he's about to leave the sanctuary, and something unique happens. There's an angel that shows up in the presence of that tabernacle. Zacharias freaked out. Last thing Zacharias thought was, I mean, my move of God in the house of God, and there stood an angel. I've seen a lot of people scared to death in church sometimes, you know. What are they doing? I came from a church. When I got saved, I was in a church. This lady behind me let out a blood-curdling scream. I was just chasing her down. I just wanted to know who she was, so I went to her church. Everybody started shouting. The mouse got loose, or whatever, the squirrel got loose in the church, and everybody just did everywhere. And I said this to God. I said, Father, I said, if you get me out of here, I promise I'll never come back. I promise. I don't know. I was back the next night. Something got a hold of my heart. Zacharias is in the praying. And the angel of the Lord says this, thy prayers have been heard. Come. What I did not tell you was the Bible says that Elizabeth was Mary, his wife, and they were well stricken in years. Stricken in the Hebrew word means at least 60 years old. So it said well stricken, which probably meant they were somewhere between 70 and 80 years old. So he said, your prayers have been heard. So a lot's going on in Zacharias saying, what prayers? Your wife's going to have a baby. Now, dude, I'm going to tell you right now. Zechariah had prayed that prayer in at least 40 years. given up on a prayer that they laid on their faces before God and asked for a child. They had forgotten, but God now did. What was her name? Marietta Woodward came across this place over 100 years ago and laid seed in this ground about young people and birthing something alive. Prayers that had been prayed for the city years and years and years and years ago. Many prayers that you've prayed for your own lives and about your children and about a lot of things that you're waiting on God. You may have forgotten. I want you to throw your spiritual mic away and quit expecting something the moment you think you need it, because God has timework and framework all designed that has your best interest with it. Play something, so I'll shut up. Just get over there and play. You
Oh.
turn to Pastor Nicky. God bless you. They watch us, and they need to see God.